I want to welcome everybody very warmly to the 2023 annual Palgrave Lecture. I'm Vicky Peters, I'm one of the editorial directors at Palgrave Macmillan. So our annual lecture was inaugurated 4 years ago to mark 20 years of the revived Palgrave Macmillan brand, which is a recognised force in academic publishing in both books and journals. So of course, our publishing history goes back much, much further, more than 100 years further, under the Macmillan name. And this year, we are covering the pressing issue that is so much in the news of artificial intelligence. And whilst this is a very current issue, Palgrave Macmillan has a very long tradition of publishing on tech-related subjects and how they relate to the humanities and social sciences. For instance, we've been actively publishing on ethical issues in this field for more than a decade. And a great strength of Palgrave Macmillan is our interdisciplinarity, and you'll see that represented today as we draw on a number of different subject areas to talk around this central theme. I think we'll have the next slide. Thank you. And one of the wonderful things about working at Palgrave, and there are many wonderful things, but one of the wonderful things, and today is all about celebrating this, is the chance to work with brilliant authors who are often the foremost scholars on very, very important subjects, but also working with the highly dedicated and knowledgeable staff we have here, publishing on the full range of subjects across the humanities and social sciences. Which brings me on to giving a really warm welcome also to our four speakers who are with us today. Our keynote speaker is Professor Kathleen Richardson, who is Professor of Ethics and Culture of Robots and AI at De Montfort University in Leicester in the UK. Kathleen is series editor alongside Teresa Hefferman of our Palgrave book series, Social and Cultural Studies of Robots and AI. And she authored the first book in the series herself, which was published in 2018, and more recently co-edited a book in the series on man-made women, the sexual politics of sex dolls and sex robots. Kathleen has been working in this area since the early 2000s, when she began her doctoral studies in social anthropology, studying robots and artificial intelligence at a time when there were only a handful of social scientists and humanities scholars working on these kinds of topics. So thank you so much, Kathleen, for joining us. Kathleen's lecture will be preceded by a talk by Anil Chandy, who's based in Singapore, but is in Scotland today, who is Vice President for Humanities and Social Science Books for the whole of Spring and Nature, which gives him sort of ultimate responsibility for all Palgrave Macmillan editorial staff across the globe, and there are a lot of them. And he'll be talking about the potentials of AI in our company and in our industry. And following Kathleen's talk, you'll hear from two of our commissioning editors who are both who work out of our New York office. Robin James is editor for music, sound, communication and philosophy at Palgrave, and Amy Invernizzi is editor for philosophy and religion at Palgrave. And they will both talk about issues around AI and tech and building their own very impressive book lists. Next slide, please. Today's lecture is pre-recorded, so we will start off by playing you the four talks, and then we'll come together again for a live Q&A, and the event will last for 1 hour. There are some bits and pieces of housekeeping on this slide. If you want to ask a question, please submit it via the question box, not the chat box. They have slightly different functions on this platform. If you're having any technical difficulties, please use the raise your hand function. Someone will assist you. And you should feel free to use the chat function to engage with one another, but do note that is not moderated. A link to the webinar, well, the recording of the webinar, in fact, will be sent to you following the event. And please do give your feedback afterwards. It really does help us with creating content in future. We'll start running the film in a few moments, but I have been asked to mention that as it was done on quite a tight deadline, there may be some small imperfections that remain in the AI generated captions, which we could perhaps take as a sort of ever-present reminder of the limitations of AI. So I hope you enjoy the talks. We can start running the film now, and the speakers should all turn off their cameras and mute while we do that. Take it away. Thank you.
It's a great honor to be invited to speak at the 4th annual Palgrave Macmillan Humanities and Social Sciences Lecture. My special welcome to our keynote speaker, Professor Kathleen Richardson, and warm greetings to colleagues and friends. Artificial intelligence is dominating all current conversations in academic publishing. Generative AI is recognized to have the potential to rewrite the rules of content creation, vetting, and dissemination, and possibly the way we work and our domain in its entirety. We are thus at an exciting, as also uniquely reflective moment, where artificial intelligence intersects with the vast and intricate domains of academic scholarship, its preparation, and its use. Alongside such developments, the integration of artificial intelligence into systems and processes has become a focal point for academic publishers like ourselves to secure both innovation and efficiency. It's my pleasure to share a snapshot of Springer Nature's, and as a part of it, Palgrave Macmillan's vision and work as we navigate this transformative era. And to stress, as one of the leading academic publishers of humanities and social sciences, the Palgrave Macmillan imprint has a key responsibility to balance the narrative. Springer Nature, under which Palgrave Macmillan operates, was an early entrant into this conversation, pioneering the use of algorithms, processes, and tools, and what would later come to be known as generative AI to enhance the authoring process. We are the publishers of the world's first AI-authored book, Lithium-Ion Batteries, in 2018. Most recently, our authors and Springer Nature editors worked together using generative AI to create an academic manuscript in German language, whose title translated into English reads, Possible Applications of GPT in Finance, Compliance, and Audit, all in one hack day, and publishing the final book within a few months, roughly about half the time that it normally takes to publish. The hallmark, and perhaps the key takeaway of this experiment, was not just the capabilities of the generative AI to operate and prepare writing structures under a set of prompts from expert authors, but that it showcased a unique human-centered and collaborative approach. The generative writing process allowed authors to access and apply AI in a symbiotic workflow, refining and enhancing the manuscript through a prompt ping-pong approach. This project and book has now been shortlisted for the Booksellers 2023 Future Book Awards. In this context, AI's role wasn't to supplant the nuanced understanding of human knowledge, but to augment the capabilities to analyze, to understand, and to disseminate knowledge. Such an integration has the potential to accelerate knowledge dissemination, but also democratize and level the barriers to authorship, providing tools for those who may otherwise find the writing process time-consuming and with formidable language barriers. As we embrace AI's potential, we should also grapple with its implications for the humanities and social sciences. These fields, which explore the depths of human experience, culture, and society, are now at an inflection point with AI's advent. The potential uses of AI in these disciplines are many, from detecting bias in research to mining vast historical data sets for new insights, and even the critical analysis of economic trends, political movements, market trends, and consumer behavior, thus enriching the strategic insights available to decision makers. There is also a level of risk that without the intervention of human experts to make sure that the interpretation and meaning of studies that are developed are not altered. And any ethical framing or regulatory environment for the use of AI has to involve perspectives from the humanities and social sciences. And as of this time, Palgrave Macmillan has published or is in the process of publishing works in all of these topical areas. The future of AI in humanities and social sciences for us is not merely a narrative of machines and algorithms, but one where human connections, values, and emotional intelligence play a central role. As technology journalist Kevin Roos registered in a recent Holspring lecture, the age of AI underscores the importance of human connections. The humanities and social sciences keeps us grounded, ensuring that as we traverse this new technological frontier, we remain attentive to uniquely human aspects of our existence. The critical perspectives provided by these fields, such as those presented in Professor Richardson's seminal book, Man-Made Women, challenge us to examine the societal impact of technology and underscores the ethical, behavioral, and cultural dimensions that AI and related technologies, such as robotics, can influence. It is in this critical examination that reminds us of the values, ethics, and humanistic principles that must guide technological advancement and our own applications of it. We view AI, therefore, as a means and not as an end, and I would like to signpost five broad areas involving Springer Nature's current and future work with AI. The first and foremost is our focus on expanding our range of titles that delve into how AI intersects with various academic disciplines. That is our primary role as a scholarly publisher, to offer a platform that gathers the best of scholarship and to make sure it reaches the attention of readers all over the world. We recognize the importance of understanding AI, not just as a technological tool, but as a subject that deeply intertwines with human life, culture, and ethics. By producing content that interrogates and explains AI from these angles, we aim to contribute significantly to the academic discourse around this transformative technology. Yet, we have to be cautious that, as shown in our experimentation described earlier, that we do not remove the human from this fundamental endeavor. Second, the advancements in generative AI offer numerous possibilities to improve and enhance our products. Our goal is to ensure these enhancements directly improve user and reader experiences. This could manifest in more refined search and discovery functionalities, embedding our content, additional features for users to access, or the seamless integration of AI's synoptical capabilities within our content. Such improvements are aimed at providing better, more intuitive experiences for both readers and our customer channels. Third is the application of AI in improving our author services. The application of AI in author services is a key area of development. Automated summaries and enhanced translation capabilities are just the beginning, and in post-publication scenarios of making readers aware of a book or article, as well as generative AI, is poised to make a difference. These tools can significantly reduce the time and effort required for authors to produce, to localize, and to publicize scholarship, thereby broadening their reach and impact. Fourth is transforming our operational processes as a publisher. AI's role in changing and improving our operational processes is substantial, from enhancing peer review processes, both in terms of time taken and identifying expertise, to strengthening rights and integrity checks. AI can streamline many aspects of our workflow. Integrating AI into our editorial and metadata systems and workflow engines will not only improve efficiency, but also ensure higher quality and integrity in the content that we publish. Fifth, and perhaps most important, is that we commit to continued experimentation within AI within ethical boundaries. Our approach to AI integration is cautious yet forward-looking, guided by established principles and Springer Nature's AI innovation framework that every AI application and project has to adhere to. This ensures that our innovations are ethically responsible, legally compliant, and aligned with our mission and values. In all of these endeavors, we take our cues from academia. The academic community's design and support provide the guidance for our initiatives. While there are concerns about AI replacing human efforts entirely, we see AI as a tool that, in the hand of experts, can greatly enhance our ability to channel, identify, vet, publish, disseminate, and publicize exceptional academic work. It's not about replacing human capabilities, but augmenting them to achieve greater efficiency, reach, and impact. In conclusion, our commitment as a leading academic publisher is not only to keep pace with technological advancements, but is also to lead the way in ethically and responsibly integrating these tools into our publishing processes. By doing so, we aim to empower the academic communities of researchers that we work with and contribute to the broader discourse on AI and its role in shaping our world. Thank you.
I'm Kathleen Richardson, Professor of Ethics and Culture of Robots and AI at Montfort University. And I'm going to give a talk today, From AI to Robots, Writing About Representational Technologies of the Human. And I'm very honored to give this Palgrave Macmillan keynote lecture. So thank you very much to Palgrave for inviting me. The first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to talk about our annihilation anxieties that we have with machines and all these technologies that seem to be coming into our lives. So a day doesn't pass when we're not worried about some form of this technology. Either people are celebrating how this technology is going to change us, completely transform what it means to be human, while others warn of immediate threats posed by the technology to jobs, to women, to children, to young people. And so it goes on. And so we never have this never-ending stream. And clearly, there are lots of stakeholders who are invested in these debates in one way or another, from those companies that are producing the technologies, that want to make profits from them, to other people who are impacted and affected by their uses. So we really do need to think carefully about what's going on and the challenges that these technologies pose. And that's why I'm delighted to say we do have a series at Palgrave called the Social and Cultural Studies of Robots and AI. And this series is really looking at all these different strands of these emerging and existing technologies and their impacts on people. And we really wanted to think about the ways in not just the technology narratives of them, not just those who are producing them to get to script or narrate these technologies, but how we can think about their wider dissemination, how they're impacting on people. So we've had a lot of great titles in the series, everything from chatbots to the sexual politics of sex dolls and sex robots. That's one of mine. Thinking about robots on the battlefield, a couple of very excellent edited volumes, including Cyborg Futures, thinking about these technologies more broadly, responsible AI in Africa, thinking about political activism, so the limitations of social media, thinking about how we might frame these technologies, so enchanting robots, and so on and so on. We want to have a series that really invites a diverse range of academics to come and think about these technologies and think about discrete aspects of them and also apply new theories. I think that's one thing in the series. We have such a range of different lenses in which these technologies are understood. So that's the kind of themes that we want to keep cultivating in the series, and it's urgent and necessary. So that's a bit about the series. But I'm just going to tell you a bit about my research because it's very interconnected with the series and the themes we talked about earlier. So my research explores the relationship between persons and things, humans, animals and property, reality and fiction. So for a long time, I was going into robotic labs, which I did my field work in, and I was hearing the robotic scientists say, well, there are fictional robots, but what we're doing is we're creating real robots. So not like those fictionals, we're like really taking the fiction and making it alive. And actually, as time went on, you know, it was like an irreconcilable difference that I couldn't resolve in any way. How could it be possible that something in fiction could be made into a real thing? So I realized that in fact, what people are actually doing are creating more fictions. So when you narrate a story in a book, it's a type of fiction. And when you create something in the lab, it's another kind of fiction. And what do I mean by that? So I created this umbrella term called representational technologies of the human. And it's an umbrella term that includes any image. And it doesn't actually matter what the marking tool. I mean, sometimes when we think of image, we think of a photograph, but actually a symbol is an image, or an etching on a surface. So it's anything on a surface. It's imitating, copying, and reproducing. And I got the idea for this approach from reading the works of Walter Benjamin and also Michael Taussig. So you might be wondering what Michael Taussig is an anthropologist. He wrote this fabulous book called Mimesis and Alterity. So you might be wondering, if I'm talking about humans, why have I got pictures of turtles? There is no turtle actually on this surface, right? All we have on this surface is a photograph of a turtle, which is itself an image on the surface. But there are other ways in which we can create images on surfaces. We can create three-dimensional images on surfaces. And I think what's interesting about this image as well is that you can keep abstracting almost indefinitely of the image. So if you see the carvings on the right, they are only very minimally as detailed and complex as the photograph on the left, but we still kind of know what they are. So this idea that actually writing is something, and I'm saying writing in the broadest term. So I started to think about technology as a form of writing, and because it includes the way we put images on surfaces. So if we look back in time and we look at the Lascaux in France, these cave paintings of animals, we can see that human beings for thousands of years have put images on surfaces. And there's all kinds of reasons why human beings might have put these images on the surface, which I don't have time to go into, but it's a very interesting tale. And then we have the Book of the Dead. So these are more images on surfaces. So rather than think about this discrepancy between a fictional thing and a real thing, which roboticists do, I started to think of actually, they're all different kinds of images on surfaces. So they're representation, they're representing some, representing something about us. And so I just want to focus on women, because in the last few years, my focus has been about representations of women and how they are reproduced in technology. And so I've taken something from a film, something from a technological practice and a product here. And actually, they're all images on surfaces. The images on surfaces have been created. The referent has been an idea of woman. The primary idea of woman in all this is someone who is a female who's subservient and pornographic, that gets reproduced throughout this imagery. And men are often featured in these scenarios as dominant and in control and having power. And of course, this is reproduced again. It doesn't actually matter whether the image is in a fiction or in a product. So whether it's Ex Machina, you have the robot character kneeling down before before an interrogator. You have so-called sex dolls hanging from hooks, Roxy the robot with its creator. And the kind of image that's on this surface is a pornographic one. It's a pornographic representation of women. And then when you look at the childlike ones, dolls and so-called robots, they also are kind of representations of women and, sorry, of children. And here I've also included Sophia the robot, which was actually another way to show to degrade women through this technology. So here the robot is displayed at an investment initiative in Saudi Arabia. It's granted citizenship in a country that doesn't have full democratic rights for women, still has a guardianship system in place, according to Amnesty International. So all these, it's men in the background moving, controlling the representations of these women, controlling the kind of bandwidth, if you like, about how women are viewed. And unfortunately, this is primarily significant. And I just want to say something about deepfakes before I go on, because over 90% of deepfakes are non-consensual pornography of women by their boyfriends or ex-boyfriends or other types of men in their lives. And unfortunately, the whole discussion primarily focuses around political figures, which make up a small percentage. And it just shows the power imbalance. So the thousands of women affected by this technological practice are ignored or minimized, while the power brokers, often men who hold power, are the focus of these technological practices. So I'm gonna come to a close. It's just a short talk. So if I'm saying what technology is a kind of writing on a surface, then what are humans, right? And what are non-human animals? I argue in my work that we're not images on surfaces, reducible to mimicry, imitation, and fiction. We don't exist on surfaces. This is a still from the original play of Rossum's Universal Robots, where the robot character was first created. So in order to believe these representational technologies of the human, You need to have a surplus of fiction, a constant need to speculate and then draw on imaginaries of them. So actually, you're always creating new fictional forms. I think any representation that is outside of us is an image on a surface, whether that image is inside a computer system or, you know, whether the surface is soft or whether it's hard, it doesn't actually really matter. But we are not like that as human beings. We are living, breathing, relational, social beings. So I just want to kind of bring it to a close with the politics of love, because the only way you can believe that human beings and images on surfaces are something proximate to each other, or is by believing in the idea that people and property are somehow the same thing. So the politics of love, as I've called it, doesn't believe that human beings, nor animals, nor natural beings are property, even though they are turned into property, into social and economic systems, they are not. So I would like to see kind of more work in this area, moving from away from this idea that we are just like images on surfaces, and more a refocusing on how we are living beings and sentient. And I think that approach will not only enhance human lives and create new ways of living where we can respect each other, but also create better environments that value the natural environment and also protect animals in the process. So thank you very much, and I'm going to end it there.
Hi, everybody. I'm Robin James, and I'm an editor here at Palgrave Humanities, where I acquire in philosophy, music and sound studies, and communication studies. Since Amy's list covers the philosophy of technology side of our philosophy list, and she's going to talk about that, I'm going to talk about what scholarship in music, sound, and communication can bring to issues of AI, robotics, and contemporary technologies generally. So back in the 1990s, Afrofuturist music critics like Mark Singer and Kodo Asin noticed that the origins of the English term robot were in the Czech term robota, which the Czech used as slang for slave. Music scholars have used this observation to theorize the significance of Afrofuturist music from artists like Missy Elliott, Janelle Monáe, and Beyoncé, who have all used robots as characters and as costumes to make Black feminist musical statements. In this context, scholars aren't studying actual robots or machine intelligences, but instead they're studying how musicians use representations and figures of these technologies to comment on and intervene in more fundamental sociopolitical issues like racism and sexism. For example, Eric Steinskog's 2018 Palgrave title, Afrofuturism and Black Sound Studies, weaves together Afrofuturist theories from scholars like Alexander Wehelei and Yatasha Warmack with musicological analyses of work by artists like Flying Lotus and Hieroglyphic Being to show how sound and music are central modalities in the Afrofuturist theoretical tradition. Now, beyond representations, of course, there have been musical robots for over a century, and scholars have been studying them for just as long. As John Philip Sousa's 1906 screed against gramophones and player pianos titled The Menace of Mechanical Music suggests, automation has been an issue in the music industry for well over a century. Similarly, we have nearly 20 years of scholarship on the meaning and value of pitch correction software such as AutoTune and Melodyne, and I would love someone to pitch me a short book using that scholarship to discuss current debates about ChatGPT, which automates writing. And I think that's an interesting project because the scholarship on AutoTune shows how this pitch correction software has had both negative effects regarding the de-skilling of vocal performance, but it was also repurposed much in the same way that Black musicians repurposed turntables into tools not just for pitch correction, but for musical creativity. I have a few forthcoming titles in my music and communications list that examine AI and robots as they have been used in the music and communications industries. So first of all, I have the Palgrave Handbook of Critical Music Industry Studies, which is co-edited by David Arditi, one of the leading experts on the impact of streaming on the music industry. And this handbook's contributors discuss many of the numerous ways platforms, streaming, AI, machine learning, and digital surveillance are all impacting how music is made, heard, and distributed. Similarly, the co-written book Platformed, How Streaming Algorithms and Artificial Intelligence Are Shaping Music Cultures by Tiziano Bonini and Paolo Maguda considers both the power of platforms over users and the agency users have both with and against those platforms. Tech moves fast, but humanities scholarship takes a bigger picture perspective that focuses on the enduring issues like inequality, extraction, ethics, communication, aesthetics, and so on. Given its longer-term workflows and timelines, humanities book publishing is especially well-suited to focus on these bigger and more enduring issues. And that's definitely one of the things I look for in book proposals related to current technologies. By the time the book is actually published, the tech may have changed multiple times, so the book needs to speak to issues that can be generalized from the examples of the specific technologies in that book. And reflecting on these bigger issues, I think, is especially relevant to technology, especially in the case of AI. Artificial intelligence is nothing but us, not in the Soylent is people sense, but in the sense that AI is trained on literature, art, music, that is, on the humanities. And who has a better knowledge of all the prose, images, and sounds that AI has been trained on than humanities scholars? So I think humanities scholarship is not peripheral to, but actually central to both the broader value questions about tech, but also the basic mechanical questions about tech as well. Thanks.
Hello, my name is Amy Invernizzi, and I'm the editor for Palgrave's Philosophy and Religion Books program. As an editor, a significant part of my role includes overseeing both our ethics program as well as the technology portion of our philosophy program. I spend a lot of time thinking about my role as an editor and supporting research that can help us to better understand the various dimensions of technology beyond just the scientific and technical perspectives. Humanities and social science scholars are indeed at the forefront of providing a well-rounded understanding of the potential impact that new technologies will have on our society, which can be relevant for everyone from educators to policymakers. As technology, and especially artificial intelligence, has been advancing at such a rapid pace, it's more important than ever that we pay attention to the critical role that non-technical disciplines can have in our technological future. For my book program specifically, I work with philosophy scholars who examine a range of propositions related to technology, and again, especially to artificial intelligence. They're asking questions like, can a machine act intelligently? Can a machine solve any problem that a human would solve? Can a machine experience consciousness? Are human intelligence and machine intelligence the same? And if not, how do they differ? And of course, how can we make sure that we're utilizing these new technologies in an ethical way? On that note, I'll say that I am most interested in thinking about the ethical dimensions of emerging and advancing technologies. It's undeniable that there are many exciting potential uses for these new technologies, but it's also important to take a step back and think about how humans can ethically design, make, and use these new technologies, as well as how we can make sure that the technology itself is behaving ethically. Some ethical challenges that philosophers have raised and have been examining include things like potential biases in AI systems, whether advanced technology will exacerbate social inequalities or help to bridge the gaps, machine and robot rights, including, you know, whether they should have them or what those rights should be, the potential weaponization of artificial intelligence, the possibility that AI will be used to replace human labor, how technology might impact privacy, and so on. All this is to say that while AI is often associated with technical and scientific disciplines, the integration of other disciplines is also essential for creating digital systems that are not only technically advanced, but also beneficial, ethical, and aligned with human values. So as an editor for Palgrave, again, it's my goal to support research that gives special attention to ethical and human context and is also mindful of our societal needs. I'm happy to say that we've already published a number of books that help to support this goal. For example, one of the best-selling books on my program is Ronald Sandler's Ethics and Emerging Technologies, which examines social and ethical issues associated with a wide array of emerging technologies. We've also recently published a book entitled The Impact of Artificial Intelligence on Human Rights Legislation by John Stewart Gordon, which examines the impact of AI on human rights by focusing on the potential risks and proposes creating a universal convention for the rights of AI systems. Additionally, I have a number of exciting forthcoming titles in this area, including an introductory textbook on the ethics of emerging technologies, which is meant for students, a monograph entitled The Emergence of Mind, Where Technology Ends and We Begin by Jeffrey Cain, and several books which examine the specific ethical challenges related to new technology, including some of the questions that I mentioned earlier, as well as providing potential ideas and frameworks to help us overcome those challenges for the most positive societal outcome. In closing, I'll say that at Palgrave, we're passionate about cutting-edge research and supporting new innovative ideas, and in that vein, I'm really excited to pursue more scholarly works in this particular space, which helps us to ask the challenging questions that are critical and necessary as this technology becomes ever more integrated into our everyday lives. I'm especially aiming to pursue more reference works, including handbooks and textbooks, that can be useful to scholars, researchers, and students as we continue to look toward the future of our society and what that looks like with these new advancements in technology.
Thank you all so much. I invite all the speakers to pop their cameras back on. Hi, Robin. And I'm not seeing Kathleen yet. Well, I was going to sort of thank you all so much, but my kickoff question was going to be for Kathleen. So I'm not sure if Kathleen, can you hear us? I think there may be an issue. So maybe I'll start off with one of the other questions. We've had some lovely questions in from the audience. So I might kick off with one to get the discussion going that might be, I think, perhaps more for Anil than the others. I'm not quite sure. So I'm going to give it to Anil first. So this question is, the internet was introduced to the public before real controls or protections could be thought about or put in place, and a lot of measures were introduced after it was too late. How do we ensure that we are keeping on track of the risks of AI and protecting the public or our communities, I suppose, from its negative consequences?
Yeah, thanks. It's thanks for the question, and also before I answer that, thanks for some excellent talks, Robin and Amy, on aspects of subjects which we probably do not immediately see applied to AI, music, for instance, and of course, ethics. Of course, is an evolving area, but there is much broader use of AI and intersection with AI than the usual subjects in the social sciences. So thank you for your discussions there. To your question, Vicky, I think this is also an area where we are learning as we go along. The framework that I briefly mentioned, and I'm assuming that this question is within the scope of Springer Nature's how we see AI, rather than I can't speak for the rest of the world. There is many experts talking about at many conferences, political leaders and others leading that conversation. But within Springer Nature, what we have established is a sort of very clear governance framework for what we do with AI. So there are many projects being put forward, which can assist us in many areas of our publishing. I mentioned a few during my talk. And what the governance boards do, and this layers up in terms of there are steering committees within that, which ultimately moves up to a final okay or green lighting of projects, which depending on what the intersection those projects have with various fields, the key thing is that we, as a publisher, we have to respect the rights of the creator. We have to make sure that compliance in terms of all, everything related to legal and our audit processes are always 100%. At the same time, we have to be innovative in what we are thinking about it, because there are specific things which could add value to both the both the output that we create, as well as how we go about creating that. So I would say at this time, because as I mentioned, while we have been experimenting with AI for a number of years, the sudden spurt in interest in this field has only been, say, 6 months or so. Regulatory frameworks will also be, to an extent, conditioned by what happens externally, if there are specific policies or laws, et cetera, that we need to adhere to. But within our organization, I think this layering of decision-making and governance, and these boards are also populated by experts. I know that over one third of Spring & H's staff now are those who come from technological backgrounds, in addition to all of the publishers that we have. So there is a good mix of people from both these fields, which enables us to essentially keep an eye on how things develop. I'm not certain if that answers it, but I would say, like I said, we are learning as we go along, but nevertheless, we are also cautious and forward-thinking around this.
Yeah, thank you very much. And glad to see you back, Kathleen. That was a question. I don't know if you heard the question, Kathleen, which was about sort of making sure there were controls in place for AI development, because the point was made that controls on the internet were maybe a bit too slow coming. I don't know if you want to comment on that briefly, but we have some other questions for you as well.
Yeah, I'm very sorry that I missed some of the last talks, the internet. Just make you wonder how it's going to take over the world sometimes. So I kind of look at this a bit like, in philosophy, there's this idea called the trolley problem. And it's, most people have heard about it. You've got a train and you've got two tracks. If you go in one direction, you might hurt six people. If you go in another direction, you might hurt one. So you make a choice. People see this as hypothetical, like, usually in reference to things like autonomous cars. But actually, that's the choice you're making constantly when you use these tools in your business. You are actually making a choice. You're handing over responsibility to these agents to basically make choices. And they're inevitably going to be like not working for everybody. And there's going to be some compromises and some people are going to be affected. Now, the problem is, are you able to pick up when things go wrong? And the answer is, often systems can go very badly wrong before any human oversight becomes a part of it. So in the UK, there was a big scandal. They introduced an automated system in the post office, and it was a computer system that went wrong. But people were bearing the brunt of the responsibility for it. And it actually took years to go to the High Court, and people committed to, I mean, there were real serious consequences. Now, when you're in an enormous bureaucracy like Palgrave Macmillan, how are you going to ensure that that's going to happen? And that would be my question to the publishers, really. So that would be on the, like, administrative, how you administer a big bureaucracy using these types of tools.
I think I might pass that back to Anil, actually. You perhaps didn't hear everything he said before while you were off, but I don't know if you want to make a quick response to that, Anil.
Yeah, I think that's what we touched upon, but thanks, Kathleen. Yeah. I won't touch upon you calling us a bureaucracy. We try to limit our bureaucratic credentials a little bit because we want to be known more as creative people, but at the same time, publishing. Scholarly publishing and scientific publishing does have several structures built into it, which we need to keep to ensure that we publish scholarship that is of the quality that our readers expect and researchers expect. I was briefly talking about earlier about how Spring & H has established a governance board. Now, that might sound a little bit indeed bureaucratic. However, the key thing is that you have to have human oversight, and that oversight has to be provided by experts who have the necessary technological as well as the societal as well as academic credentials to evaluate what the projects are and how we actually act on them. So as new technologies and as new trends, AI, certainly we've experimented with it. And I'm not going to say here that there will not be things which we may learn from some of the mistakes that we make. It's not going to be a zero mistake area. Possibly we hope to make it that. Nevertheless, there is always a possibility that we'll have to course correct at some point and lead to making things better and more equitable in some senses. Having said that, so it does go through several channels of looking at exactly how this technology will affect us and what a particular project utilizing AI will also act. And the ethical frameworks and the governance framework around it. I mean, we put in place a governance framework within Springer Nature, but of course, this while that is absolutely what we need to follow within the organization currently, we expect this to possibly be added on as regulatory environments, etc., change. Even governments are looking at it at this time, and we possibly will learn from that and adapt to it. And that's, I think, a key aspect of how we see it.
Well, that's good to hear, but don't forget the people on the ground who like have the real experience of these, of their authors, of the systems, of the ideas, of everything. I guess don't just attribute all the power to a governance team. It sounds a bit Star Warsy. But I know lots of people do this, but there has to be communication through all the different levels of operations, I think. But I'm sure you know this.
You just talked about the role of editors, and we have two editors here. I don't know if either of them want to make a little comment on that, and then we're going to move on to a slightly different topic. Robin looks like she's going to say something.
Yeah. Yeah, I was just going to say, like, one thing I always keep in mind is that in philosophy, we have a term called non-ideal theory, which means not sort of assuming the world is perfect, but that assuming that the world is rife with imperfections like sexism and racism and, global inequalities and things like that, and just recognize that, like, you have to start thinking from that. And so, like, when I'm looking at projects that talk about technology, that's, I'm looking for things that recognize that, like, this is going to disproportionately impact people. Kathleen, this is sort of something that you were kind of picking up in your last comment, right? That, like, don't center the most privileged people in the world, things like that. So just kind of recognizing that technology exists in an imperfect world and not in a perfect one.
Mm. Amy, did you want to comment at all on that?
I mean, I think Robin said it really well. I also look for projects that are kind of looking, I mean, especially from the ethics standpoint, thinking about how we can make sure that ethically we're working with technology and AI. So I think that as long as we're having that in mind, we're hopefully going to avoid the issues that Kathleen is raising. But.
Yeah, thank you. So what I was going to move on to, we've had a couple of questions in, which are in this sort of area. You've started to touch on a little bit of sort of thinking about diversity. And there are two questions which are quite different, but they're in very similar sort of area. So I was going to read them both out and see who might like to sort of take them together. One is, as AI has been so influenced by white and heterosexual men, as well as the data which is used to teach or train AI, how do we ensure that AI does not repeat and enhance the same issues and toxic misconceptions that are perpetuated in society today? And the other question is asking a similar thing, but a slightly different way. Does the panel know of any women working in the tech space who are developing AI tools or policy that is changing the unbalanced gender role narrative in new and exciting ways? I don't know who would like to take that sort of little pair of questions first.
Yeah, I mean, to be fair to some of the technologists, things have been identified as going wrong, and the technologists themselves have started to address things and think about things more carefully. So some things, not everything, because some things are taken as given, right? You have to kind of problematize the initial idea that in my work that women are sexual objects you know, and that's taken as given that women are sexual objects. So you have to do a lot of work just saying that actually there is a history to that idea. There is a particular politics around it. There's consequences from it. So I would say that, you know, to give them some credit, but there is work to do. And I guess by having, I think you want as many different ways of thinking about problems as possible. So for me, can the social sciences solve these global inequalities? Maybe not, but they can at least reflect on them and, you know, reshape them in that way.
Amy, you look like you were going to speak.
Yeah, well, I guess I don't have really an answer to the question, but more just a comment about like this exact kind of question is why it's so important to have the humanities and social sciences kind of in conversation with technology, right? Because, you know, those are the folks who are going to be asking these questions and bringing those questions to the forefront. Whereas, you know, maybe folks who are very in the technology space won't be thinking of those things. And so having the two disciplines kind of in conversation will hopefully help to mitigate some of those problems as technology is kind of developing.
Yeah. Absolutely. Any further thoughts from anyone?
So just to say, I work on a European project with a group of scientists developing virtual reality. And my role on that project is trying to develop the ethics around these technologies. Mm. Now, ethics itself is very conceptual. You know, it's some of it is very conceptual on how to make it grounded and practical for people working in the space. You know, there are some real difficulties there. But I think because the European Commission have driven this ethics agenda, and so all projects now have to include an ethics component, it means the scientists, particularly the ones I've met from Europe, take this very seriously. And I would give them credit and say they're really engaged with the process well. I don't know if that happens in smaller companies or big corporations or what the landscape's like in the United States, but I found that certainly in Europe and the UK.
Yeah, that's really interesting. We've got very little time left, so I might move on to one more question. I think it'll be the last one. I'm sorry to those who've asked questions, which we're not going to answer. A lot of them have come in so suddenly at the last minute, but I really like this question. How do we ensure that authors, scholars and professors are still valued for their specialisms and that they are not overtaken by the ease of getting data from AI, especially as archives are increasingly becoming digitized?
Can I take this one?
Sure, yes, please do, Robin.
So a hallmark of humanities scholarship, especially book scholarship, is that you're making an original contribution to the scholarly conversation. And at this point, all that AI can do is sort of reframe things that other people have already said, right? Mm. So you really need an expert, a human expert there to have an original idea to make that new contribution to scholarship. And I often find that among some of the most original scholarship, what really informs that originality is the scholar's lived experience as a person, perhaps of a specific racial or national or religious background, a person of a specific sexual orientation, things like that. So the very human qualities of being a person living a particular life in the world is really what gives originality to scholarship, and AI doesn't have that yet. So I think we're safe.
Yeah, I would definitely agree with that in the sense that AI, I mean, we use all these terms like thinking machines and relating machines, but they aren't actually doing any of these things. We're just using anthropomorphic terms. And what we know about the humanities is that human beings have kind of, some of the stuff we're doing today, we've done it in the past. We're just doing it in a new way, in a different way again. And so, you know, the humanities and social sciences can contribute to that by having this oversight about the human experience.
Yeah. Maybe Vicky, if I can add just a line there. I think as academic publishers, you know, we normatively, we are very close to the norms that academia sets. Yeah. So as academic publishers, I mean, we are guided by that. And if I were to take an example from the last question which was posed, I think if you what differentiates this particular, although the change might be far more revolutionary and radical, depending on the capability of what the machine can do, what distinguishes it possibly a little bit from the early days of internet-related research is that the kind of diversity-related conversations, the kind of conversations around potential bias and other things, I mean, there might be programs which obviously could be accused of all this, but nevertheless, those conversations are a lot more there with the right characteristics at this time than it was during the early days of the internet. So the checks and balances scenario, both in small companies and big ones, and the overall narrative around it is also influenced to an extent by that. At the end of the day, also, we are working with scholars who constantly will correct us if we are going in a certain direction. And I think as publishers who work closely with them and are part of that conversation, we are always listening to what that is and course correcting as well. Having said that, there was a conversation around or a question posed around whether there was more sort of gender diversity, etc. I can say for sure that within our own governance framework, which I briefly mentioned at all layers, I think we try to make it as diverse as possible and link it to our overall DEI strategy as well in terms of what the projects are. So it's never something which is specifically done only for technology sense, only for the sake of technology. Rather, we are quite clear that we should not, as human beings, you know, AI lacks the agency. We should not remove the human element from that agency question.
I'm going to stop you there. Thank you so much. We want everyone to come back next year, so we shouldn't go over time. So I want to just thank everybody so much. I think from what you've all said, I feel like the really important thing is that actually we're having these conversations and discussions at all. Thank you all so much for being part of it. And thank you to our audience for showing up and listening and asking such good questions. And I feel like it's been a real sort of rallying cry for the importance of the humanities and social sciences. And that's great. That's kind of what we're here to propound. So thank you so much to all of our speakers, Kathleen, Anil, Amy, and Rob. Just a quick thank you also to our behind the scenes marketing and events staff, Helen Waller and Fariel Zuber, who worked really, really hard on this, and to my co-editorial directors at Palgrave, Stephen, Felicity, Charlotte, and Ambra, who've all helped an awful lot in putting this together, and Rachel Ballard, who is Kathleen's editor, who has helped to sort of bring everything together as well. So thank you all so, so much. And yes, we'll be back next year. Next year will be the 25th anniversary of the Palgrave Macmillan rebranding. So yeah, thank you all once again, and we can end it now. Thanks.
Thanks everyone.